Hi, thank you for coming to the India panel. We have an economy that's slowing down. We have concerns about inflation. We have a weak currency. We have a dependence on imported oil, and we have a gridlocked government. Oddly, we're not talking about the United States. We have a distinguished panel to talk about the challenges that India faces now. To my far right, we have Gaurav Dalmia, the founding partner of GTI Capital, Sanjay Patel, the managing partner of the Apollo Management Fund, Raghuram Rajan of the University of Chicago, and Ryan Pinto, the CEO of Ryan International Group of Institutions. I'm Andrew Morse. I'm the Deputy Bureau Chief of the Wall Street Journal here in Los Angeles, and I'll be moderating today's panel. Let's get right to it. India's economy seems to be slowing down. The RBI cut rates by a greater than expected 50 basis points, but has said it's not going to do much more because it's afraid of inflation. What does this do to the economy? Sanjay, let's start with you.
You know, I think the economy is going to slow. There's no doubt about it. And they're trying to stimulate it. Whether or not India has a 5% growth or a 7% growth, I'm not sure is the real issue. Actually, when I think about the economy, you know, India has a $1 trillion economy. And 5 to 7 is, you know, roughly $50 to $70 billion of dollars of growth a year. Honestly, I think both those numbers, and we'll maybe talk about this later, relative to China, China's you know, 7 times the size of that. So when you talk about the difference, a 5 to 9% change in China is a large number. A 5 to 7% change in India is actually surprisingly not that big a number. So you actually have to think about it in aggregate dollar terms. So I'm actually less worried about whether it's 5 or 6 or 7. I think if India isn't growing between 50 and 70 billion of output a year incrementally, that's a real problem. But actually, in the context of the size of the country, the population, it's not that, surprisingly, it's not that big a number. And people kind of forget that when they think about, you know, India.
But the government wants to maintain growth rates of, you know, roughly 9% per annum. If you're growing at 5, 6, 7, you're below that. What does that do for the economy, for stability in the government, Raghu?
Well, I think it's a wake-up call. I think this government has grown complacent based on the growth of the of the world economy in the period 2003-2007, and some sort of measures that were taken in the early part of the noughties, so to speak. The BJP government did a lot of reforms that also provided a momentum for this government, which carried it through its first term. And I think what we need to recognize is that you need to constantly do the things that are necessary to generate growth. And the government basically thought, you know, you could spend the growth, but you didn't have to do what was necessary to generate. I think that realization, though, is coming to bear in Delhi. And that, I think, is sort of the cup half full, cup half empty part of this. The fact that growth is slowing, that things need to be done, that all the factors you mentioned, large current account deficit, which there are some mitigating circumstances we can talk about later.
Okay.
Inflation, very high, large fiscal deficit. All these things present a terrible macroeconomic picture. And with growth coming down to 6%, people sort of understand that something needs to be done. I'm hopeful that message has gotten into Delhi. I certainly think from my discussions, it is getting there. Now, can they actually act? That's what we need to watch.
Okay. Gaurav, you actually invest in companies in India. So would you tell us how much of the slowdown in the Indian economy is because of domestic factors, and how much of it is based on factors beyond its control, the problems in Europe, the slowdown in the United States? How do you see those dynamics interacting?
Well, first of all, I think there's a remedy to disappointment that we are facing with India, and that remedy is have low expectations. if you factor in that the economy will keep growing at 9% every year, there's bound to be disappointment. As a businessman, our factor was the economy is growing at 9%, but the sustained rate of growth will be somewhere 7%-ish. So given that that was our underwriting model on our businesses, we are less disappointed, I should say. Now, we're in the cement business, for example, which is one of the most local businesses there is, and it's not affected by the global's ups and downs. And the cement business, which was growing at 12% a year, is growing now at about 9% a year. So it's a 25% slowdown. Now, that's quite a large number. It's quite a big slowdown, but it's not disastrous. It's still 9% growth in a cement-type industry is still a decent growth. If you took a last 20-year average, it's better than that. You know, if you took a last 5-year average, it's worse than that. So I would say there is distinctly a local slowdown. And you can see it in cement. You can certainly see it in big sectors like infrastructure and power and things like that. The consumer side is holding up very well. But clearly, there is a local slowdown, which we have only ourselves to blame.
Okay. Ryan, you are in the education business. Is India's population educated enough to help the economy grow in value-added sectors? And if so, which ones do you think are most attractive?
Well, Andrew, firstly, I want to thank God for this opportunity for me being here, and thanks for the Milk Institute, and of course to my distinguished panelists for bearing with me on this panel. I think on the economics perspective, I think my fellow panelists will do a much better job talking about policy and the government at large. You all have much better experience, much greater knowledge. I'm coming in from the education side. And when I look at the economy, when we look at the economy, we look at it from the people's perspective. So we are the world's youngest and the largest population ever in the history of man. We have 500 million people under the age of 25. That's greater than the population of all of North America. That in itself is a great asset, but it can be a great liability. We have about 400 million that should be in school, but about half are in school. And that number trickles down, filters down very, very quickly when it comes to high school graduates. You have about a 70% dropout rate by the time kids leave school and they go into higher education. So that itself is a great challenge. And I mean, India is a country of great complexities, and this is something of a complex problem. And it's a great challenge. But of course, there are great opportunities in there.
All right. Guav, let me ask you, are you able to find the staffing that you need for your companies?
Well, I think talent is a big problem in India. If you look at wage growth in urban India, wage growth last year in our businesses was about 14%. This year it'll be about 12%. Now, 12 to 14% wage growth shows there's a shortage of talent. If you go down into, blue collar jobs, most industry runs vocational training institutes in-house. And the reason we run it is not because we want to run it, but because without that, you don't have a productive labor force. So clearly there's a shortage of skilled labor, there's a shortage of talent at the management level. So for all the talk about so-called Indian talent, I think there is a talent shortage in India right now.
Okay. Yeah, Andrew, can I just say something about this whole issue around infrastructure, and it's both infrastructure for people and general infrastructure. I think one of the biggest constraints to growth for the next 20 years in India is infrastructure, of all sorts. It could be educational, it could be physical. And to me, the inflationary pressures that India's facing, it could be the loss of food, because there's no logistics, which keeps food prices high. It could be wages, increasing because we don't have, enough local talent. It could be, the inability to move goods around because we don't have the roads. To me, that's a huge issue that the government hasn't dealt with. In China, which is an investment-driven, model, it kind of, that's what they did. In India, we haven't done it. And the government, I'd be curious what other people think, but the government's kind of decided to try to do it privately, and I just don't feel you can kind of build the infrastructure of a country with private capital, because the rates of return that private capital need is just too high. And I think that's a big issue across a lot of dynamics.
So could I?
Absolutely, please.
I think India's good news and bad news. Let's first remember the good news. The good news is what Ryan talked about, a huge country with a young population with dependency ratios, the number of old and young as a fraction of the total population falling. This is precisely the point at which every Asian economy took off. And you can see that. You can correlate the increase in Indian savings rates with the reduction in the dependency ratios. Savings rates are increasing, investments increasing, investment per worker is increasing. That means more productivity. That's great. Second reason for the India story is there are very low-hanging fruit, which can be plucked, so long as you have enough governance capacity to pluck it. Building roads is a no-brainer. Getting people out of agriculture into services, into industry, implies immediately a tremendous increase in productivity. That was the China story. The 10% growth wasn't by doing things really, really smart and finding total factor productivity growth, which is how the West grows. It was by moving the low productivity worker from agriculture into industry and services. That's a 20-year story which could play out in India. The bottlenecks are very clear, and that's the bad news. That is, in the rapid growth over the last few years, India hasn't created the governance structures that will allow it to grow. For example, corruption. Why is corruption a big issue? Because you never had institutions in place to dole out spectrum, to auction land, to auction natural resources. These weren't thought of as important in the early years because there's plenty of it to be had. Now that the prices have gone through the roof, you can see the extent of corruption in the allocation. But there has been a public reaction, and I think the government is trying to do these things. So I think you need to look at both sides. The potential long term exists and hasn't gone away. The short term paralysis is in part because of the previous growth and the fact you didn't create the institutions. Now there's an awareness the institutions need to be created. Do we have in India the time to do it before all the macroeconomic concerns start coming to the fore?
Well, let's talk a little bit about that. You said that growth could be stimulated by moving people out of agriculture and into higher value-added activities, but the government heavily subsidizes the agricultural population. How do you square that? Anybody.
It's where the votes are. it's where the votes are. Agriculture support prices have been higher. Now, that said, I think you are seeing the migration slowly but surely, not from the rural areas to the urban areas. That has been slower in India than elsewhere, but from rural from agricultural activities to rural industry. I mean, you have to understand that a town, a village in India is 5,000 to 10,000 people. So it's what would be a small town elsewhere. So you can find a lot of activities there that are non-agricultural. And that is happening, which in fact, I mean, to some extent, I think we are under-measuring the amount of agricultural area growth there is in India today. And that, in a sense, again, if you want good news, India is dependent on its own demand. And it's creating enough of it. That's, in fact, a problem. There's inflation. But in a period when the industrial West is slowing, if you can channel that demand appropriately and provide the supply side, things could look a lot better 3 to 5 years from now than they look today.
I think the macro is, I agree with all of that in terms of the macro factors. The micro around this is, you have coalition politics, which caters to the, don't forget, most people in India who are voting are not particularly educated. The coalition politics will always favor people, the dispossessed, effectively slowing a lot of the reforms that are needed. That's fundamentally what's kind of going on. So I think I agree with Raghu that I think we need to create the institutions, but it's going to happen more slowly because of the nature of the democracy of India. The good thing is, in the power of the press and the judiciary in India. I think that those are two huge things in India which are very, very valuable, because the press tends to take up the issue, which doesn't happen in China, and the judiciary tends to be actually generally not corrupt. And I actually think those are the other side of having a very, very, you know, democratic country, which by definition, by the way, I just don't think tiger is the wrong word for India, because it's kind of an elephant that kind of lumbers along. And I think people just got to, you know, tiger is, you know, implies a lot of forward, you know, a lot of strength, you know, which is aggressive. India's just kind of lumbering along, and it'll lumber along for the next 20 years.
Well, you brought up the judiciary, so let's go right to that, because the government in its new budget seems to be challenging the judiciary in the 50-year retrospective tax question that it's raised. Mm-hmm. Something, foreign capital fled India in the wake of that budget announcement. How significant is it that the government will challenge a ruling that came down in January? And how should foreign investors look at the rule of law in a country where it seems to be revisited with a five-decade time horizon?
I think this is politics. Other people can comment who live in India, Gaurav, maybe. I think this is totally political. I think eventually it's going to, I think the judiciary will have its way. I mean, others may disagree with me, but I think this is politically motivated. And so I'm not that worried about it in the context of the long term, but the short term, you know, listen, lots of people are rattling around trying to figure out whether or not there's going to be a tax implication for Mauritius and all the structures that are in place. Unclear what Vodafone did right or wrong. You know, I hear that they hadn't, you know, done it right. So there's, you know, there's some micro issues there. So I'm generally worry about it, but I don't think it's a long-term issue.
I tend to share Sanjay's view. I think there's more rhetoric in this than a real bite, and I think it'll be scaled back. There's no way they can implement something like this.
So you would just put money into India and not worry about retrospective tax charges?
I would put or not put money into India for other considerations. I would not put this as an A item consideration.
Okay.
Right. I mean, the two questions here. One, are they going to wind this back? Probably, but not directly. I think they will tax Vodafone because they've sort of said they would do it. They will find a way to do it, and I'm less sure that the Supreme Court can intervene at that point. But they may make it up to Vodafone in other ways and be nice to Vodafone. Does this reflect a desire to go against the foreign investor? And I think the answer is absolutely not. I think what this reflects is the sense that there was about, 5 to 10 billion, depending on how you count it, in taxes they could reap from these kinds of transactions, which are transactions done abroad, exchanging assets in India. They felt that if they went light on Vodafone, they would get a tremendous amount of flak from the opposition. Remember, the opposition and the ruling party, this is one of the few things they united on, which is we cannot let this amount of money go untaxed, when it was pretty clear in their view what the intent of the legislation was. But does this reflect a more serious move against foreign investors? No. I think the Indian government understands that it's extremely dependent on foreign investors. And I think if anything, going forward, you should hope, hope is the right word, that they actually liberalize more FDI into India.
Well, overnight, an Australian telecoms company, Swedish telecoms company dropped out of the spectrum auction. A Norwegian company says it's thinking about dropping out. It doesn't feel like India is a particularly welcoming environment for foreign capital. You're a foreign investor.
Yeah, we have capital in India. I think India is a better buy. We're a contrarian investor at Apollo, so we think about investing as a value investor, and it's actually been very hard to invest in India. India has been one of the most expensive equity markets for the last 20 years, trading at about 13 times EBITDA. And it's actually now trading at about 8 times EBITDA. So I actually think, as a pure financial investor, you got to think through all of these issues. But if you believe in kind of the long-term potential, And it depends on your time horizon. You know, strategic will have a longer time horizon than us. I actually think it is a good time to potentially buy into India because valuations are better. The markets were quite thin in India, and as a result, with FDI flows, foreign capital would come into India at times where people were bullish about India, drive prices up. Now everyone's negative about India. So I think from my point of view, actually, this is the time to look at India and think through all the issues, think about it. And if you believe in it long term, I think, you know, this is, I would like to buy good companies cheaply. You can buy some very, very good companies quite cheaply, which, by the way, may not be totally dependent on India. You know, some of the companies in India actually, have revenue outside of India. So I actually think it's not as simple as saying, oh my God, it's terrible. I think you got to look at the business. You know, we're in micro investing of looking at businesses. So I'm going in the other direction. I'm spending more time thinking about whether or not we should, you know, spend more time thinking about investing today than when everyone is going into India. So that's my personal view.
Ryan, does more foreign direct investment, more foreign companies in India create opportunities for your business? Is there training that needs to be done to get young Indian men and women ready to work in a foreign corporate environment?
I think absolutely. I think the gap between, as I was mentioning, students coming into high school and then going into higher education, but I think there's an even bigger gap from when students leave higher education institutions, universities and colleges, from the time they get recruited and they start working. You have campus recruitments and the likes of that, but you have companies like Tata and Infosys where they have to go out and spend hundreds and millions of dollars building training institutes, building training programs, so that they can recruit qualified students but then retrain them. So there is a gap there. It has to kind of fall back, go down to the roots in education, what the curriculum, and getting them industry ready for the job market. And you have about 15 plus million entering the job market in India every single year. And if the greater opportunity is introduced, definitely there'll be more, if I could call it, investors and partners coming into India to maximize on that opportunity.
So, Raghu, how important is FDI to the growth of the Indian economy?
I think it's very important for two reasons. One, India has been running a persistent current account deficit, and the safest way to finance that deficit is through FDI, rather than through short-term borrowing. So, one, that's very important. Second, you learn. I think FDI brings in knowledge. FDI brings in good practices. FDI brings in outside competition. So I think that over time, you can see India generally move in the direction of more liberal foreign direct investment. And I think you should see that happening. India's not gone as far as China in some ways. But it has also not been as restrictive as China in terms of requiring sharing of intellectual property and so on in other ways. And I think going back to this is going to be one of the big markets in the world, 1.5, 1.7 trillion right now, depending on how you count. But even 6, 7% growth over the next 10 years, it's a good place to be in, especially if the industrial West is not going to grow that fast.
Gaurav, you obviously think that India is a good place to invest in. Tell us a little bit about the broad opportunities and then a little bit more specifically about the areas that you like.
Sure. Well, I share a contrarian view somewhat to what Sanjay was talking about. So in 2007, I would quote Yogi Berra often, saying, no one goes there anymore, it's too crowded. And every deal that you would look to invest in would have been an auction. Hiring talent was a problem, and so on and so forth. I think the situation has changed. Capital is more respected today, and I think there's a better upside today than there was in 2007. I think there's one underlying theme that defines opportunities in India, if I had to pick one underlying theme. And think of that as an operating leverage in the hands of an Indian consumer. So let's assume he had 100 units of salary, and he was spending 80 units on his day-to-day expenses, and he had $20 of disposable income. And let's say he got a 10% income growth, no taxes, no inflation, just for simplicity. So his $20 in disposable income went up to $30. So even though nominal wage growth is 10%, you will find that disposable income growth may be 30%, 40%, 50% in the hands of millions of Indians who are crossing that threshold. So you have boring businesses such as automotive in the rest of the world, which are fast-growing businesses in India. So keeping that lens in mind, I think there are tremendous opportunities in India in fairly boring and mundane industries.
Okay. I'd say I agree with that. I think there's one kind of theme, though, that we are thinking through, and maybe if we can get slide 19 up, it'll be helpful. This is actually an interesting slide, because I agree with everything that Gaurav said. I think one of the things that is happening, though, in India is that there's a lot of leverage, and people kind of miss it. Basically, entrepreneurs in India, with the growth that Gaurav talked about, tend not to want to sell equity because they don't want to dilute themselves. And most companies in India are owned by promoters or families. And so they tend to actually put debt on their companies, and both at the company level, at the personal holding company level, to build plants and so on and so forth. And one thing that's happened is that the cost of borrowing in India is quite high, given the government borrowing rates. And so typically entrepreneurs are borrowing at 15 to 20%. And one of the things that we've noticed is that the leverage in the system has actually increased pretty significantly. And there's as it's shown here, $130 billion of debt, where the companies that have more than five times debt to EBITDA, which in a metric outside of India is pretty high. So I think you'll have some slowdown as a result of that. Although the underlying companies will have growth, maybe if they grow less than 15%, leverage will start kind of creeping back in and impacting businesses. So this is a theme that we're trying to take advantage of. We think it's an interesting time to make investments, because entrepreneurs will sell you equity when they are over leveraged, and they may sell you equity at a good price, whereas typically they don't want to sell you equity. So all that being said, you kind of want to buy equity now. We kind of want to buy equity in good companies with bad balance sheets, which is a theme we tend to focus on in our business at Apollo. But I think you got to kind of, again, look at the underlying business and look at the growth opportunity of that business. I think consumer businesses are great. Real estate, we were talking about it earlier. I think there's the demand-supply imbalance in residential real estate is just enormous. Demand for it, given the population and given the fact that people are moving out of the houses, way outstrips the supply of residential real estate. So you can kind of pick your industry verticals, and you'll see a lot of growth despite all of this.
So from one property bubble to another property?
No, I mean, it's not a property bubble at all, actually, because banks in India actually don't lend to real estate, and most real estate, so actually the banks made it through the financial crisis because they actually did not. Banks are actually in very good shape in India, despite what I just showed you. Corporate debt is high, but banks are actually in reasonably good shape with very good capital ratios, because they weren't allowed to do a lot of real estate lending, weren't allowed to do a lot of derivative lending, so it was a very conservative banking system. And actually what happens now is that people in effect finance the purchase of real estate, because you prepay, so you buy an apartment and you have a progress payment. So the developer, in some cases, doesn't actually have to borrow. The borrowing is from the consumer. So it actually doesn't impact. It's not going to be a property bubble. Prices are rising. And maybe in Bombay and some big cities are very high, but I think the general opportunity is, I think, pretty attractive.
India has 23 towns with a population of more than 1 million. So you may have bubbles in pockets, such as New Delhi or Mumbai, but to say that all of India is a bubble is the wrong statement.
Mm. Okay. So like the United States, it's a market of markets.
Right.
Okay. There are some foreign hedge funds that are taking some rather aggressive stances in India right now, including suing the government. This is not a tactic that I think India has seen very much of. It's one that has been tried in the United States and in Japan and other places with mixed success. How do you see this playing out, and how might it make Indian companies feel about accepting foreign investment?
I think this is, again, an example of the governance structures not having adapted to the growth. So the case in point is Coal India, which is a monopoly public sector producer of coal, which has failed miserably in expanding coal production, partly because of constraints beyond its control, such as land acquisition and environmental permissions. And what they've done is, what the government has done is essentially told Coal India that you've written all these contracts to provide coal to the private sector producers and you're not providing it. Well, by hook or by crook, you have to find a way to actually produce the coal. And if you can't produce it, import it. Implicitly implying that Coal India will have to swallow the losses if, in fact, it provides coal at the agreed on price but imports it. Import prices are higher for coal. At this, a minority shareholder in Coal India, the Children's Fund, has basically said, you know, you sold us shares. You sold shares to the public. You are now a publicly held firm. You cannot act as if you are a government firm. And therefore, you cannot do what the government would do. You have to respect the rights of minority shareholders. And this is something that should have been said, you know, 3-4 years ago when the government was using the oil companies to effectively do its job by subsidizing oil prices and forcing the oil companies to swallow losses. The ministerial reaction has been, no, these are public sector companies. You should have known they were public sector companies and they would do the government's bidding when you bought shares in it. And of course, the hedge fund is saying, no way. We bought into a company, you sold it as if you would respect minority shareholders and you have to respect them. That battle will go on, but I think it's very good because it's told the government, you can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't disinvest and then treat this as government property. My sense is some compromise will be reached on the coal issue. And I'm not sure it'll eventually get to a coal battle, to a court battle, but I think this is all for the good. This is going to improve governance in the public sector firms, make the government understand that it has to respect minority shareholder rights, and improve the pricing it can get for those shareholders. So again, I would urge you to see all this as a gigantic battle going on in some sense for the institutions in India. And my sense is, you know, your sort of view of India over the next 20 years depends on whether you think the right side wins in this battle or not.
Well, you bring up the government trying to disinvest. Last year, it wanted to sell $8 billion in government companies. It was only able to sell $2.8 billion. This year, it's hoping to sell $6 billion. It doesn't seem like there's a thriving market for state-run companies. Is that because of some of these governance issues, this uncertainty about governance?
Yeah, I mean, I think it probably is. I think people are, I think the, coming back to the activist issue, I think this is great. It's actually great that TCI was willing to do what they're doing. There were some others who are also doing it because, you know, minority, you know, the market will not get efficient without this. This, you know, I actually sit in London and I'm in Europe all the time. And by the way, there's as much inefficiency in the public markets in some jurisdictions in Europe as they are, you know, as there is in India. So I can again take it on a global, you know, if you can allocate capital globally, you know, it's interesting that Chris Hahn, who runs the Children's Fund out of London, is looking at Coal India. So I think, you know, the question for institutional investors on privatizations is always price and, you know, rights and governance. And so I think, you know, at the end of the day, price maybe plays a high, you know, a big part in whether the government's willing to sell at a discount at a price that people are willing to buy. And I think price expectations, the one thing I always find in India is price expectations are very high relative to the issues that, you know, the country faces. So people kind of try to oversell equity. So I think it'll be partially dependent, I think, the outcomes on whether prices are set at a price that people want to trade at.
So, but broadly, at a sort of higher level, you think that TCI's activities, and I think the other firm you're referring to is QBT Financial, that the actions that they're taking are starting a debate about corporate governance in India that will clarify corporate governance practices broadly throughout the country and make it an easier place to invest.
I hope so.
I think it's increasing the awareness level for sure. It's a part of the evolution and maturity of the market.
It didn't work in Japan.
That's Japan.
One of the things that's going on is the education of the government also.
Yeah.
There are too many bureaucrats in the Ministry of Finance who haven't had much experience of the markets, who basically think the world is dying to get into India, and all they have to do is just open up a little bit and people will flow in. For example, the mispricing which issue was it that LIC took up?
ONGC, I think.
ONGC.
I think, yeah.
This was the Oil and Natural Gas Commission, big public sector firm, some shares being sold. They priced it above the market price. I mean, you can buy the shares in market. Why would anybody go and buy it in the public offering? And obviously nobody bought, and another public sector firm had to go out and absorb all that issue so that it wasn't a failed issue. But this is the kind of learning, I think, that helps educate government bureaucrats. And there are some pretty smart ones in there, don't get me wrong, but it creates a broader awareness. And I think, the good, why it helps to be a contrarian in India is the downside brings a lot more learning into the government process and may create some positive reaction.
So there's an education process going on for the government. Does that create a business opportunity for you, Ryan?
Interesting but difficult.
let's move on to foreign affairs. It's widely known that India recently tested a long-range missile that brings Beijing and Shanghai within striking distance. I don't think anybody is overly concerned about a war breaking out in the near term. Nonetheless, that does speak to concerns about balance of power in both India and China within the region. How do you see this playing out? How important is it? Is India going to spend more on defense? And if so, does that distort the economy? Gaurav, may I start with you on that?
I don't know Raghu's view, but I share it.
Raghu. and could we have, I think it's slide 13, defense spending or military spending?
Yes, there.
It's 13, military expenditure in India, please.
So, not being an expert, but let me tell you, my sense of India's attitude towards China has a lot to do with 1962, which is when India lost a war to China. It lost it because Indian forces were terribly underprepared, and Jawaharlal Nehru thought that he was friends with the Chinese leadership and never thought that the noises they were making should be interpreted as aggressive. India lost a chunk of territory at that point, and there's been a border dispute ever since. So there is an active war which has been fought between these two big countries, and there is a fair chunk of territory which is under dispute with, for example, the Chinese government saying it won't give visas to people from the state of Arunachal Pradesh because they consider that territory Chinese territory, and therefore they see those as Chinese citizens. And therefore, they won't give visas to them. They just have to apply for a Chinese passport. This is the kind of dialogue at some levels. The good news is trade between the two countries has been exploding, and it's now north of 60 billion and growing fast. So in that sense, the idea that countries that are heavily integrated trade-wise, investment-wise, are not going to find it that easy to go to war, hopefully that binds the countries together. I think the missiles are sort of India's way of saying, think of us as bigger than just Pakistan. India doesn't want to be clubbed together with Pakistan always. Of course, Pakistan doesn't want to move away from India. So a week after India fired its ICBM, Pakistan fired a missile saying, we've got it too. But really, I think India is very wary of being seen in the West as the counter to China. So in any, it is also very, it knows that China has a great fear of being encircled. So it wants to be strong enough to stand up to China, but not be used as a tool by the West. And that's sort of the game, games to some extent that India is playing. Be friends with Japan, be friends with the United States, but try not to give China a sense that it's being encircled, and then India is part of the encircling forces. That sort of politic is being played out. Will this imply tremendously higher defense expenses in India? I don't think so. I don't think there's any politician in India who thinks India has the capacity to match China. But it does mean that as India creates room, it will increase defense expenditures to upgrade the quality of Indian forces. That is going to happen. India is also focused on its navy, trying to expand it so that it creates enough.
They want to create a nuclear triad.
They want to create a nuclear triad. So there is all that ambition, but as of now, it's not to the point where India thinks it's in a military race with China. I don't think that is the prevailing view.
And is that good for investment? That money will be spent on social issues, will be spent on infrastructure, and not spent on bomb making, missile making, boat making. Gaurav?
Since I'm not in the arms business, I think it's a very good.
Sanjay?
No, I think that's right. I think, you know, there's this the concept of India being aspirationally close to China. It's really aspirational. I come back to the size of these two countries. You know, India's 1.5 trillion, and China is 7. You know, and it's just the scale of it is very different. You know, they have the nuclear deterrent, which I think is enough. And I think the more they spend on, as long as they continue to spend on infrastructure away from defense, is going to be much better. They're going to be better off.
So you think it's bad investment?
Defense spending?
Not all defense spending, but sort of getting involved in.
I think at the end of the day, it's making sure that they're probably, I mean, relative to Pakistan, which I think Raghu talked about, I think the 90s, it was all about India and Pakistan making sure. And as we all know, Pakistan has been not a particular, has been a place which has, you know, in effect, sponsored terrorism. And from a U.S. perspective, it's good that you have a strong country next to Pakistan, because at the end of the day, we all know Pakistan's a pretty bad actor in this whole world of terrorism, given everything that's happened. So having enough power, military power, to kind of offset Pakistan is, I think, is pretty important geopolitically. I think offsetting China is, as I say, I just think it's aspirational as opposed to real. So as long as, you know, it's probably good for the country and good for, you know, the globe that India spends something on defense. But the truth is, it's like anywhere else in the world, including the US. The more we spend on wars, the less you spend on, you know, your own home market, you know, infrastructure and the like. So
I should also add that, you know, the popular sentiment in India is not anti-Pakistan. I think the test of India-Pakistan relations are actually in the streets of New York, where Indian and Pakistani cab drivers hang out together. You know, so I don't think there's an impending risk of India going to war with Pakistan in the minds of people in India. And to the extent good leaders are good followers, you know, the politicians in India follow that sentiment.
I'm going to ask two last sets of questions and then open it up for the audience to quiz you all. The first is on S&P's move last week to downgrade the outlook for India. A move, if executed, would drop it into junk status. What do we think of this?
Fully appropriate given the current environment. But it's sort of a warning, so to speak, a shot across the bows. And I think it has had some positive effect in Delhi. Certainly, there's a little bit of soul searching. The people who dismiss it as, oh, you know, it's inevitable, they're going to do this, rating agencies don't carry any weight, and so on. there are some voices like that, but there are other people who are saying, let's stop and think about what's going on and let's try and straighten things out. So I think it could have some positive effect. It's certainly deserved given the macroeconomic picture. India needs to do three or four things over the next few months to regain broader confidence. Let fuel prices go to international levels so they don't weigh as a huge subsidy on the budget. Bring in revenue-raising measures like the goods and services tax, which is on the anvil. Be more open to FDI. There's already talk of bringing back multi-brand retail, which was proposed then taken off during the parliamentary session. But also let foreign aviation companies come in to India. They need that. That's a no-brainer. And finally, pass a few bills which are stuck in government. Pass the non-controversial bills. If they can do these four things, it could change around sentiment a little bit. Once you've lost confidence, it takes a long time to regain it. But you could change around sentiment a little bit, and you don't think that this is a train wreck waiting to happen. So hopefully all this pressure, the pressure on the rupee, all that comes together to change things around a little bit in India, and then you can focus more on the long-term story, which I think is good.
So like the activist investor shareholder lawsuits, this is going to start a conversation that hopefully will...
Absolutely, and India has those conversations. You have to read the press, the financial press, and you know the conversation is going on. So those are all good things, I think, that could happen.
Agree, disagree?
I agree. I think market forces, I think the S&P reaction is appropriate. And I think the market, it'll help reprice the market for securities in India to a level which we think is interesting and appropriate. And then ultimately, if the cost of capital to the country goes up, by definition, given the ratings are going down, hopefully, economics kind of win out in the long term, which I think they generally probably do within the context of, a complicated, democracy. And, if cost of capital goes up, I think the government's going to start thinking about what they should be doing. As Raghu said, and there's a whole series of things they need to do. And if they don't, the cost of capital will go up. Listen, Europe's facing it, just in front of our eyes. The cost of capital of every European country is going up, and they have to do austerity, maybe, to deal with it. But politically, it's very hard to do austerity. So the same issue is being played out in lots of economies globally.
Well, I agree. I think it's a step in the right direction. Two or three years ago, the sentiment in India was, where else will the money go? And it's humbling from that sentiment for this downgrade to happen. And I think it'll propel positive things in India.
And one last set of questions. The last time the United States went into an election cycle, India took some heat for outsourcing. We're coming up on an election cycle. Do you see that becoming a topic in the campaign rhetoric? If so, how will it play out? Infosys already seems to be positioning itself at hiring 1,200 people in the U.S. How do you see that playing out? Sanjay.
I think it's not a big deal. I think this outsourcing thing is over. There's lots of overreaction, in the sense that I think the outsourcing companies have now grown beyond the borders of India. Maybe coming back to what Gaurav said, it's actually hard. Wage inflation has increased the price of people in India to the extent that it is cheaper, in some cases, to go to other jurisdictions, including Ireland and some European jurisdictions, et cetera, where there's high unemployment. And there is talent available, so I'm not sure. I'm not thinking that this is going to be a bigger issue now than it was the last time around. Is my view.
I tend to share the same view. I think it'll be more of noise, if at all. But I don't think there's going to be any direct cutback on bringing people over from India or outsourcing work to India.
So you think that is going to continue to be a strong sector in India?
From a demand perspective, I think it'll be a reasonably strong sector. But from a margin and other perspectives, things are different because wages, as Sanjay was just pointing out, have moved up quite a bit.
So if demand for outsourcing for these types of services is rising, is that an opportunity for you, Ryan?
I think there is an opportunity in terms of training for people into that particular sector. And that's already growing. it hasn't stopped despite all the talk.
Great. Well, I'd like to open it up for questions. Does anybody have one? Jorge has a.
Thank you. Thank you. This has been a really excellent panel. I'd like to ask Sanjay and Gaurav if you have any comments about housing. Clearly, enormous demand. Talk about the youth population. So there's enormous potential for demand. You mentioned about mundane industries, you know, refrigerators, stoves, and so on, that could create an engine of growth. What's your view about where that all stands in terms of the planning?
Well, I think residential real estate is particularly interesting, as is probably low-income housing, just because I think, depending on the price point that you're in, you know, the issue on low income is, can you make it economic? Cost of land has gone up, and aggregation of land in India is very complex. Doing it is actually very hard because it's typically owned by farmers, and there may be a lot of, you know, cash involved, etc. So as an institutional investor, it's very hard to play that or feel comfortable sometimes playing, you know, real estate in India. But it's all about aggregation of land because the cost of construction is actually pretty low. So bulk of the value in, you know, when you think about owning real estate in India is actually in the land and has been historically. And so, you know, ultimately the economics, depending on the market you're in and the price point you're selling at, it's a pretty good risk reward from an equity point of view. It should be a pretty good risk reward from an equity point of view. But, you know, again, it's very localized, as we all know. I mean, real estate, I think, is definitely a local business. And I think you got to think about where you are. Commercial, which, you know, you may, Gaurav may know more, or any of the my panelists, you know, I think was overbuilt in some respects, you know, early. And I'm not sure it's the same, you know, attractive demand supply imbalances as residential.
I got it. Land, obviously, but I'm talking, for example, go to Mumbai. How do you get the people out of those slums? And that's one. So, what's your view, if you have a view about the policy perspectives, creating some kind of capacity for residential, sufficient proper residential homes?
I don't know, Gaurav.
Well, the slum clearing business is a very small niche within the total housing context of India, and inevitably these are politicized. And I don't think there is political will or the capability. And these are state-level issues, not the policy-level issues in the central government, whether there is a capability or the will in the state governments to make this happen in a hurry. You've seen case after case where people have tried and failed. Having said that, I think urban cities, the big urban centers of India, are growing rapidly. They are getting population growth of 3 to 4%, including migration. And with public transportation improving in many of these cities, they're going far-flung. And therefore, there is a lot of activity going on, even though the slums and the city centers are not being redeveloped. Unlike more sophisticated markets, where you can rezone properties very quickly, in India, rezoning becomes very complex, and it's quite arbitrary as well. And that becomes another constraint, even if you can clear the properties.
I'm not sure if this was discussed before I came in, but does anybody have any insights, I'm over here on your right, into the retroactive changes in the tax regime that's been talked about? Any insights into the government's thinking on why they're making the retroactive changes to the tax regime?
Well, we did discuss that, but I think we can go over it just at a very high level. Sanjay?
Maybe I just tell you what the transaction is. Transaction is a transaction done in the Cayman Islands, where a substantial chunk of assets which were in India were sold in the Cayman Islands to Vodafone. Okay, so the tax authorities are saying you basically transferred ownership of Indian assets through this Cayman Island vehicle, therefore you owe capital gains tax. And you know, who has to pay, et cetera, let's leave that aside. But it's a transaction that should have attracted capital gains. And Vodafone's claim is the law doesn't say this clearly. And the Supreme Court agreed with Vodafone that that transaction, which was done in the Cayman Islands, even though it was an exchange of Indian assets or a sale of Indian assets, didn't actually merit taxation. The Indian authorities are saying, look, I mean, let's call a spade, you basically transferred Indian assets, and therefore you should pay capital gains. That's how the law, the intent was written, you knew it, we knew it, and that's where the discussion is stuck, right? So I think the problem is the Indian authorities feel if they let the Vodafone transaction go through, there are about five or six other transactions, which means the Indian exchequer is going to lose something like $20 billion on these kinds of transactions, which effectively transfer Indian assets. So they say, well, we will certainly change the law now to reflect the intent, but we're not going to let this $20 billion go, and that's where the politics comes in, because if they do, the government is weak as it is, if they do let the $20 billion go, there will be accusations from the opposition that they weren't aggressive enough on taking that money back, they've sold the national interest down the river, et cetera, et cetera. So that, to some extent, reflects this particular set of transactions. I don't think it reflects an attitude towards the government going forward on foreign investors. It's just the magnitude of the money on the table that, you know, political pressures did not allow them to leave with the foreign investors. I think it would have been far better for the government to attract foreign respect by saying we're going to obey the rule of the law and our Supreme Court and do what it suggested. But this is where we, over time, hopefully the Indian government gets more educated on the working of the market. But I think going forward, it's not, you shouldn't necessarily expect more of the same.
Just to be, you know, clear, I think there's some technicality around this transaction. There is still a regime that allows you to, and a tax treaty with jurisdictions like Mauritius, which allows you to invest in India on a tax, you know, on a basis that doesn't give you a higher tax burden as a financial investor. The big issue and the big concern is that they're going to start thinking through the Mauritius tax treaties and some of the other treaties they have. And I don't know if others, you know, who are closer to it, you know, we're obviously talking about this, and you know, as an investor in India ourselves, but I don't think there's a lot of concern that the Mauritius tax treaties are going away. You know, but that's something that people, you know, need to focus on as well. And I think there's going to be lots of rattling around thinking through this over the next, you know, next few months.
I think also the government is trying to equalize the tax treatment of resident Indians and offshore capital. So, for instance, long-term capital gains for foreigners coming through Mauritius or Singapore or whatever used to be is 0%, whereas for Indians it was 20%. And there is talk now that long-term capital gains for foreigners will be increased to 10%. So there is that force towards equalization going on as well at the regulatory level.
Ryan, who live and work in India, I think the feeling or sentiment on the ground is very different. If you look at, you know, physical infrastructure development, if you look at social infrastructure development, malls and the like, you look at educational development and the number of schools that are coming up and the kind of focus from the government to spend on education in meaningful and thoughtful ways, I think the sentiment on the ground is far more positive than we may be painting today. And I think the consistent message that the panelists seem to be giving is the reason for this is more around governance and policy and the lack of thoughtfulness or consistency in execution of policy, especially financial tax policy. One thing we did not talk about is the recent state elections that took place in several states some months ago. Where the leading Congress party didn't do as well as some of us thought it may. And the question I have for the panelists is, how do you think that's going to affect the business sentiment on the ground?
Well, I share your view that we spoke more about the negative or the risk aspects of India than the positives. I think there is there are two views that you can have about India. One is a top-down view, which is what we were discussing in this panel. The second could be a bottoms-up view. And I think the bottoms-up view of India has changed less over the last 5 years than the top-down view. The top-down view has gone from euphoric to sad, and the bottoms-up view has gone from mildly positive to maybe neutral. And I see, as an Indian businessman, lots of opportunities in India today as we speak. And many of the so-called inefficiencies of India lead to opportunities. I'll give an example. So we think power as a sector is doing very well. It has to grow, et cetera, et cetera. But the power companies are constrained because they don't get clean coal. And therefore, there's an independent industry in India of coal washeries. Most mining companies in the Western world provide clean coal to power companies. But in India, there's an independent industry. So in this mess, there's an opportunity, in fact, for businesses. So I share that view. I think there are a lot of positive aspects and opportunities in India. Coming to the state elections and the fact that, you know, in the largest state in India, you have a new 37-year-old chief minister, I think these are transitionary phases. I don't think India's political landscape is changing in a hurry. I don't buy some of the stuff they are trying to sell to India, to the public, that they will be able to deliver X, Y, and Z. I just don't buy that. If it happens, it's great, but I don't really buy that. So I think politics will be a constraining factor. It'll continue to be a constraining factor, but if you're Unilever or that side of the business, you may say, I don't care. And a lot of businesses in India will actually look at politics and saying, I don't care. So I share your
Let me just jump in here. Gaurav, you mentioned inefficiencies in the Indian economy, and I wanted to ask Ryan, is education an area where there's inefficiency that your business can take advantage of?
Well, I think there are two areas that we all need to look at. One is access to education. But also, then the second biggest thing is quality of education. So there could be 200 million plus kids going to school, but are they getting a quality education? You know, one of the greatest challenges is attrition in the government schools. I'm not saying that all of the government schools, you know, they're inefficient. They do have the Kendra Vidyalayas, the Navodaya Vidyalayas. They have large chains of schools, government schools, that are doing excellent. But as a country at whole, education itself is a challenge. And I mean, coming back to the point, we are such a huge population. It's not overnight that we can come up with a policy, come up with, you know, something that will resolve this this challenge. It is a work in progress. You know, in India, we have a saying, "Talia do haathon se basti hai," which means when you clap, you need two hands to clap. So, it's very easy to say, you know, the government is not doing this or that. But at times, especially with education, because it involves just people. It's all about people. There is a government, there is other stakeholders involved. So there has to be a sense of unity to work together. And I mean, you know, we've been talking about a lot of challenges, a lot of things in terms of investment. We want to build roads, we want to build bridges, we want to build hospitals, we want to build, you know, outsourcing companies, we want to build IT companies. All of that requires people, all of that requires talent. It all comes down to, you know, the bottom-up kind of view of making sure that the long-term story of India does not change, the trajectory of India does not change. Yes, there are, you know, always bumps here and there, but as long as we have a final destination in mind, we should invest in that. And I'm so happy that, I'm sure that you mentioned, you know, in terms of, you know, in India, when we are there, you know, when we're sitting on a plane, when we're at the airport, when we're in any business, when we're in any office, there's always a buzz, especially, you know, living out of Mumbai. You know, there's always a buzz about that city. People are always trying to find opportunities, always trying to find something, you know. There is a great aspiration. When you talk about migration, it's about, you know, that huge aspiration of a farmer wanting to send his child to an education so that he can move to a great city or start his own business or go into a good company. It is that level of aspiration in India that is really pushing the economy as a whole. And, you know, being true to my nature as an educationist, you know, in challenges there are great opportunities. And I'm glad, Mr. Gaurav, you mentioned that. Inefficiencies and in challenges there are great opportunities. And opportunities start with a no. You know, there are no opportunities yesterday, but there is an opportunity today. But the greatest opportunity is tomorrow. So, you know, through all the challenges that we have a future, and I'm sure, you know, together, there are solutions, there are things that we have to look about. And it's not an easy thing, because India is complex.
So can I just add a couple of things on that? One, on the schooling side, yes, a large number of government schools don't work, but the whole bunch of private schools that have been set up tackling the same sort of poor population and getting small fees, but you know, giving them an education that you know, is not like the education you get here, but certainly gets them to read and write, which they couldn't when they went to the government school because the teacher wasn't present. So there's a lot of reaction to the difficulties that takes place. Let me give you one more example, talking about state governments. You know, one state government in India, the West Bengal government, because of local political pressures, essentially couldn't give Tata land to build the Tata Nano. There's a local agitation. They were driven out of West Bengal. But Gujarat, which is a very fast-moving state, essentially offered them the land. They said, come here, set up your plant here. And within a few years, not only is the Tata plant up and running, but there are a bunch of other auto manufacturers who set up nearby, creating a cluster of auto manufacturing. So in other words, you know, you have to be a little down on the current state of central government governance. But India has many states, each of one is a small country in its own right. And there is a lot of competition between the states. There are some states which have very little corruption. There are some states which are really fairly easy to do business in. So you have to pick where you go. And you know, given the tremendous opportunities around, there are still possibilities.
India, in my view, redefines the word patience. I got to tell you, I think people want instant gratification, you know, and feel their problems are going to go away immediately. But I think you just need to have a ton of patience, you know, and you know, I think have a lot of thick skin.
Long term treaty.
Exactly.
I want to probe that the point that Raghu just mentioned about different states performing differently. And I want to see, in your view, what accounts for that? Is it different personalities, you know, the politicians, the chief ministers in these states being different? Is it the culture of the states? You know, what's different? Is the bureaucracy different?
I think it's very complex. I mean, take the southern states, right? The southern states have generally been better, more hospitable towards business than, say, the northern and northeastern states. Why is that? Some people would argue it's really the Dravidian movement, which essentially gave rights to the lower castes and brought them into education in a big way much earlier on. And that created a better governance structure in those states than potentially exists in northern and northeastern states. I don't know. Some of these states have reasonable, Tamil Nadu has a reasonable bureaucracy, which is, you know, moderately corrupt, but the corruption is contained. The corruption is contained. Gujarat has a much less, much more transparent structure. And there are some non-transparencies, corruption in Gujarat is far more limited than, for example, in other states. That is not to say you can't make a change. In Bihar, Nitish Kumar, after many, many years of misgovernance, has given them a government which has done some small things. For example, it has put the criminals behind bars, many of the criminals. That itself has improved the law and order situation tremendously. And the fact that Bihar is now safe or safer itself creates the potential for business growth. And it's been growing at 7-8% over the last 4 or 5 years. So one of the things about India is there are lots of low-hanging fruit. If you can get the state chief ministers to sort of recognize that growth and development brings rewards, and they are increasingly recognizing that, you can get competition from the states for better governance. And that itself can add to the growth dynamic. Even if you despair of the center, at least the states are moving.
Thank you so much. I'd like to ask the panel to talk about the state of women in India a little bit. I was there 2 years ago and running a women's conference. It was fascinating to me how the women were very excited by the opportunity to join the workforce. There's an enormous potential for the same thing to happen in India that happened here when women really went into the workforce in great numbers and raised the economy of our country. But I saw a lot of barriers, one of which was the the family structure, the traditional family structure, where young women were really encouraged to stay home once they had babies. And there was a huge amount of issue. We were in Bangladesh for part of the time. Bangalore. There were a huge number of issues with transportation. So the women were spending an hour and a half to get to work, very little daycare, very little except in the family. Lots of problems that we were working with to help them solve. But I'd like to know what you see as the potential for India to take advantage of the enormous resources of women in the workforce and where it's going right now in the last couple of years.
I mean, I think it's a very interesting point and very complex, obviously. But parts of India have very matriarchal societies, and in southern India and some in some parts of southern India, totally matriarchal. The women in charge, finances, et cetera. So, India's got a long and complex history. I think there are lots of issues, but you probably know more of, and you obviously spend a lot of time on this particular issue. But I kind of think about it in different pockets, and there are obviously pockets of success. We have a joint venture in India with ICICI, which is one of the leading banks, private banks in India, where I would say that the entire top management team of this bank are women. Chanda Kochar, who is the CEO, she kind of grew up, but they had a very forward-thinking chairman, and who's K.V. Kamath, who was the previous CEO, and it wasn't that he was, he just thought about it. And you got one of the most successful banks in India, which is run by, it is what it is. But it says to me, I think it's very, you got to think about, from a business point of view, think about micro. I'm in private equity, and honestly, I have very few women in private equity. And private equity is an industry that's been around 25 years in the United States. I would say they're not that many, at my level at private equity, there are very few women. I think India's complex. I think pockets, and I think it takes a lot of encouragement, people to focus on the issue. But I think there are big issues, of treatment of women and dowry systems and all that stuff, which we can spend hours discussing.
I also think economic pressures are forcing people to rethink the role of women. I think today, if you're living in Delhi or Mumbai, the two major metropolitan cities, to be a single-income family, in a single-income middle-class family, is a very tough proposition. So families need for women to go out and work. And when the women go out and work, they obviously get more respect, both within the family and outside. So I also think there's that economic compulsion which is forcing people, and that's been internalized by middle-class India in major metropolitan cities.
There is discrimination against women. You just look at the sex ratio in Punjab or Haryana, which are some of the more prosperous states, and the sex ratio is abysmal, 920, 930, when it should be north of 1,000. So there are many missing women, children in India, and that reflects the attitude towards women. But again, it's changing. And also the government is doing some very reasonable things here. One of the big changes in India is this concept of local self-government, where villages can elect their own local bodies. And a large number of women are going into those elections for the first time, and that's changing the attitude right at the grassroots towards women. Women have been full participants in agriculture. They work in the fields. In fact, they probably work harder than the men there. But now they're getting some greater status because many of them are actually becoming village panchayat sarpanches, the head of the panchayat. And from what I understand, initially there was a sense the men in the family would tell them what to do, but very soon they become their own people, and they are actually moving towards more women's issues. There are studies showing this. Issues like childcare and so on are things that they certainly are starting to think about. But also, there's the statement about India: everything you know about India is true, and so is its opposite. If you look at women being oppressed in India, think President of India, Pratibha Patil, woman. The head of the Congress Party, Sonia Gandhi, woman. Head of the opposition, Sushma Swaraj, woman. Speaker of the House, Meera Kumari, woman. Chiefs of various states, Sheila Dixit, the thorn in the government, Mamata Banerjee, she's also a woman. So, across the board, I think you've got women in leadership positions, Chanda Kochhar being one example, Shikha Sharma. You can just roll them off. So women are starting to come into their own in India. Not to say we've done enough. There's a lot more to go, but I think at least the trajectory is positive.
Well, I was going to let the audience ask one more question, but unfortunately, we have run out of time. So thank you very much for having attended this panel.